meaningful and very positive, and have made a difference to their lives and a difference along that independent pathway to further opportunities. In terms of our workforce, we want to ensure we've got a highly motivated, qualified workforce that meets the needs of the people that we support in our service. We rely on volunteers. Volunteers are the backbone of a lot of the work that we do. We recognise the benefits our volunteers bring to the people that we support, but also to the volunteers themselves. We've got lots of volunteers that have also experienced difficulties in their journey and their life around social isolation and want to get back into the community. Around the place, we recognise that a lot of our services are delivered in really good settings and neighbourhoods, but we want a stronger relationship with the community. We want those opportunities for people that we support to be integrated further into the community. Our profile, since joining the organisation, I believe Rural Evolutions is the best kept secret. We don't tell anybody about the great work that's happening and the difference that some of the people that we support and the journeys that they're travelling on. We've got a couple of examples where we've got people in our service who are now independently travelling to alternative activities like art centres, galleries, that they would have never have done before, and now they've had that support, that encouragement, and their confidence has grown so much that they're now doing independent travelling on their own, which to me is a brilliant outcome. Partnership working, my other observation from joining the organisation is we need to work with more like-minded organisations like us and work together to gain more, because we're all trying to do the same thing, we're all trying to make a difference to the people that we support, and together we can make a difference even further. We've engaged with the people that we support, the self-advocates, the communities, and our people have got a voice now, and they're helping us share, they're helping us co-design, they're helping us co-develop products and services to meet their needs, which is quite refreshing, which is giving positive outcomes. I want to draw the members' attention to some of the other successes, which is on page 3. I've referred to...
we've got a slightly different report from you.
Page
numbering.
Apologies.
Page 21 of our report.
On that page. Some of the successes and highlights, you know, we've been working with a self-advocacy service together, all are able to help us reach the voice and for the people that we support, to give them a voice to help shape the services and activities that they want to get involved in the future. So that's been a great help and a great support from together, all are able. We're also part of a national collaboration called Making It Real, which improves the quality of the service that's delivered in Wirral Evolutions. It looks at how we can engage further with the people we support, families, carers, and making it more meaningful in a very simple language in terms of how they can get involved in the future direction of the service. We're also participation with volunteers, as I've mentioned before. We've had significant investment into some of our facilities, Royden Park, Dale Farm, Hensby Wood. Some of you councillors may have visited there on a recent visit. We're also driving up quality standards across all our service areas. And we are fostering a culture of partnership, which I referred to before. Some of our successes in the previous year is, I just want to read these out a little bit for you.
Jean, I'm sorry to interrupt you again, we have got the report in front of us, so if you just highlight the area you want people to look at.
Yeah, I'd like to draw attention to the, on the outputs, 407 people that we supported last year into nearly 544,000 hours of enrichment activities. And those activities are around arts and crafts, sport and activity, health and wellbeing, the great outdoors, catering, and using sort of the ability to use shop skills, servicing. And for me, that's a tremendous amount of hours that I want to draw councillors' attention to. I also want to draw councillors' attention to the number of volunteers last year that gave 465 hours, which is equating to 14,000 hours over a year, which if we had to pay for that resource, that would be a significant amount of investment. I'd also like to draw the attention to the case study that's in your report that is really about the support that Wirral Evolutions has done for one individual, which has resulted in a number of positive outcomes, that this individual has had their confidence improved, they now do independent travel, they've now got aspirations to be on X Factor, they want to, they've just took part in a voluntary placement to do art classes where they're teaching other young people to deliver art classes. The other part I would like to draw your attention to is, for me, Wirral Evolutions, as I said, is the best kept secret. I believe that by working more strategically and working to underpin the Wirral Council's pledges and priorities, that we can make a positive difference to the outcomes of the people that we support. And what I'd like members to do is to acknowledge the content of this report, but also to help us promote the good work and the success the individuals are achieving within themselves, and support us accessing perhaps other resources that's outside of kind contributions to the Commission. And also to come and visit us. We open our doors, we wish and we welcome everybody to come and visit us and see the difference that's being made on a day-to-day basis. And we welcome any connections from tonight to help us improve and continue on that journey. So that's everything from me.
Thank you very much indeed. I'm going to open it up to members. I've got two members who want to, three members who want to, four. I'm going to place them on to ask questions.
Thank you, Jean, for your report. It's interesting to hear about your vision and your intentions and your strategic objectives. But actually what this doesn't tell me is what have you actually done? What are the results? You talk about the your high quality and you tell me that you've got a balanced scorecard. I haven't seen it. Where is it? What's it measuring? And what performance data have you actually got? What I'm interested in is you talk about improving outcomes for people. That's fine. What are they? What have we seen? Where is the evidence that people's independence has been promoted, that people are less reliant on services than they previously were, that people are more independent? We don't have any of that information. That's certainly something that I would welcome.
Christina.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you very much for your report. A couple of things come to mind there. First of all, as a ward councillor who had an evolution establishment in the ward, I was called up until about 12 months ago to meetings every month where we discussed things. That seems to have gone now, and I just wondered why that's something so useful had been stopped. But what I had noticed was that there was quite a change in the client group over a 12-month period, and the needs of those people were so disparate that a lot of people weren't getting very much at all, and a few people who possibly needed more attention and more challenging were getting that, and I know some of the people who were wheelchair bound finding it not a cheap option, is it? So I wonder, when did the focus change of moving people with multiple difficulties all in together and trying to find some sort of thing that might suit everybody? And also, what was the rationale to the distances people travelled? Because there seemed to be, when these changes took place, concerns that some people were in the transport for over an hour while people were being picked up. And some of those people were the people with the more numerous and more pressing needs. So that was upsetting for other people who were being transported. And it seemed to me that not everybody's needs were being met. And I'm concerned that we now no longer go in and therefore can't talk to the clients.
Would you like to respond to that,
Jim? So from a history point of view, the opportunity to come and speak is always there and always has been there. So I really don't know why you haven't been given that opportunity.
Sorry, we will call and give an agenda for a monthly meeting. That's this.
What we the feedback we did get from a number of the carers is that they were happy what they were doing and they didn't wish to come in. So that's just the truth of what happened. If the requirement, or if you prefer for us to send our formal invite, then we can do that. There's no issue with that, because we do have a considerable amount of carers and parents still coming in to the service.
Sorry, that's one council.
I may have misunderstood.
As a councillor, it is within my ward, one of the illusions establishments, and we have regular monthly meetings. I appreciate what you're saying about the parents, because a lot of the parents
don't. Excuse me, councillor Muspratt, could you bring my phone on? I know you don't appear star of stage and screen.
I'm just explaining that it isn't, I'm not here sitting here as a parent or carer, I'm sitting here as a councillor. Was invited in every month to a meeting.
In response, I'm not sure why it stopped. There's a lot of things before me that had started and stopped. Since being in post, we're open for business and we're welcoming everybody in. And we welcome you in at any time. So we can re-establish that. But I don't know the reason why it stopped.
Thanks very much.
Can I ask you the questions? I ask you the questions about the mixes of people, okay?
So the locations have always had a mix of people. There was a lot of concert, a lot of people brought together, particularly around the refurbishment of Pendlebury Wood. So a lot of people were put into other services because we had to close one of our centres. When we opened Pendlebury Wood, the people with more needs then moved back to Pendlebury Wood. The mix may be different now, but we've always had a mix of people at centres. The other question that you asked me about was why do people travel? A lot of that is down to people's choice. They have created their own friends community in the centres, and they ask to go to particular centres because their friends and social groups are there. It would be more cost effective not to do that, but we're trying to serve their needs as much as our own.
Can I just say that sounds very good. It's not in fact the answers that I was given at the time. But I do welcome the fact that you will reinstate the monthly meetings of my own ward, which is Bevington, and well, I expect all three councillors will be invited on a regular basis from now on. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Sam, did you want to ask a question? Change, what would you, it sounds like there's an awful lot to continue, but if there's any
Chair, just a couple of questions regarding the provision of school governor training. I'm aware, you know, I'm a school governor, and quite often they say evolutions will be delivered in that and so forth. Could I have some more information on that? You may not have to hand it.
Can I just interrupt you for a minute? Yeah. I think, Councillor Norbury, you talk about a different organisation. Yeah. I think you talk about Ed Central. Yeah. And this is
Councillor
Gilchrist.
Thank you. It's probably been a couple of years since the changeover and moving off into a separate organisation. Prior to that, because the Eastern Building was little run down, I was able, with the cabinet member involved, Balfour Beatty, who were doing a lot of work in the area, and actually did quite a bit of refurbishment with volunteers, staff, weekends, showers, changing facilities, decorating a lot. And the front is made beautiful by volunteers at Eastern. Lots of painted woodwork and flowers now, which goes down very well with me. And the local cycling organisations train young people, both from the centre and also children at various times. But your report does talk about Lloyd and Dale Farm and Pensby Water, and whilst there are other locations, I think 11 in all, I'd be interested to know what plans there will be for upgrading the Eastern facility over time. If I said it's like going back into a school from the 1950s and 1960s, which is just a long time, and is probably beginning to be looking a bit tired, whilst your emphasis on actually helping people within buildings, not obsessed by buildings, but wanting to be pleasant, attractive, welcoming, all those things with things for your people coming to do. So I'd be interested in what development plan there might be.
Absolutely. We were in the process of doing a 5-year business plan, which will look at all the assets and the facilities, have we got them in the right locations, are we delivering the right services to meet the people that we support. We're very passionate around co-location. There's a partnership with leisure services and the Cambridge Roads look at co-location around me. So for me, you're right, some of our day centres are very 70s look and feel. We want to move away from that. We want it to be more of a health and wellbeing hub, part of the community. The principles about having, a partnership approach, having that community integration, service integration is a priority for us. But the assets that we currently occupy will be part of a review as part of the business plan. Have we got them in the right places? Because in fact, some of the locations we've got are probably we're rattling around in some of them as well now, and we could merge some of the services together and have a better quality service for the people we support.
Okay. Thanks very much. Thank you for your report. Thank you for coming here tonight. I'm very pleased to hear of the good work that you're doing. However, there's a set of recommendations there which aren't entirely appropriate for this committee. In their place, if you don't mind, I'm going to ask the committee to approve some of the recommendations. One is to say thank you for coming along tonight, but I would like to ask you to produce a further report, which can either come to this committee or to the Health and Care Panel, and it gives us much more detail about your performance data, your use of finances, and the buildings and ownership and that sort of thing of buildings. The reason behind this is because with all these services that are commissioned on behalf of the council, and I'm assuming you're getting a certain amount of money from the council for this, we like to reassure ourselves that those services are good, improving, and are meeting the requirements that we commissioned. So that's the kind of report we'll be looking for when we next ask for it, if that's okay.
Yeah.
Is the committee happy to approve that as a recommendation?
Yes.
Thanks very much. Agenda is item 8, which is a report on the 111 offer. And I think Jackie Evans, we're going to talk us through this. And Sarah Shake, is that how you pronounce it? Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Chair.
thinking. Just while I'm hoping the committee will put up, we've got a supporting presentation if somebody would be good enough to put that up. I'll just do a very quick. So just by way of very brief introduction, the original request from group members for this item to be on the work programme is to better understand the 111 service and the planned improvements. NHS 111 is a nationally mandated service and it's one of the main entry points into the urgent care system. In the Northwest, we have a single NHS 111 service and contract management for all the CCGs is coordinated by the CCG as the commissioner. Rural CCG clearly feeds into that Northwest governance and Sara, as she said, is our lead commissioner locally and who regularly is and lives into that governance. We have, as you're aware, circulated a briefing paper outlining developments in the 111 service. But we thought that the following few supporting slides that complement the paper actually might be quite helpful for people. So I'm going to ask Sara to run through those, and then we'll obviously try with Paula to answer any questions that you may have following that very brief presentation, if that's okay.
So I'm
going
to talk to you about the service overview of 111, its activity and outcomes, performance, significant feedback, including comments and complaints, and then future developments. The slides are probably a bit conservative, but they are on screen. So NHS 111 is a service that patients can phone when they have urgent health care needs 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. And since 2015, it's been provided for us in the Northwest by Northwest Ambulance Service. So it is one service for the Northwest that rural patients access along with everywhere else. But as Jackie said, Blackpool and CCD are the new commissioners, but as the CCD feed into their governments. So I'll give you some activity in terms of the number of calls from rural patients. So in May, about 4,700 calls, and you can see from the bars from last year that activity generally goes up in December around holiday periods and then drops off during the summer, and it's been quite consistent this year as well. So in terms of what happens following the call to 111, the majority of patients, so 56%, are referred to primary and community care. That's things like their own GP practice, GP out of hours, or advised to attend the ward centre. Further, 18% are given self-care advice, so this advice how to protect themselves at home or signposted to information. 15% 111 staff arrange for an ambulance to get to that patient. So that could, in rare cases, be emergency ambulance or an ambulance within a few hours to take a patient to hospital. And 9% of the patients are recommended to attend AA themselves or receive a phone call from GP within 20 minutes. And then there's 2% which is other, such as signposting. So for all 111 services, the national set of key points and indicators, and they are publicly available on the NHS England website, so I want to look at them in greater detail. But there's 5 of them that are really key, which you've got in the paper. So I've shown the target, what we achieved in April this year, and the performance April last year, just to demonstrate the changes. So the calls abandoned, we're now meeting the KPI at 2.4%, which has improved quite a lot since last year. Calls answered in 60 seconds is not meeting the target, but there has been improvement. And although it hasn't met the target, I think the average wait is something like a minute and a few seconds. The calls warm transfer KPI will notice is quite low. So this is where it's determined that a patient needs to speak to a nurse within the 111 service. And calls transferred is when patients wait on the line to be directly transferred, as opposed to seeing a call back within a few minutes. So that is low, and that is due to availability of nursing staff within 111
under 10 minutes is not achieving the KPI that has not been approved since last year, which is 100% out of the 75 target. And the clinical intervention KPI will be consistently with two over the last year, or 18 months or so. The KPI used to be a target of 30%, and it's now increased to 50%. So I'll move on to patient feedback. So this is on a Northwest basis. NHS 411 sends out 300 surveys every week. So in April
Council. Both of my questions are out of the base, I think, really. The first one was about the warm transfers, and you were saying that that's obviously a national issue because of the nursing staff. So what I want to know is what we're doing about that locally to improve those figures. And the second one was about the relationships with GPs. Obviously, you were saying the repeat prescriptions appear to be a recurring theme. So what do we do about the relationship with GPs, about regular medication reviews, ensuring those prescriptions are done monthly or bi-monthly, or whatever it is to stop that? Because obviously, prescriptions have to be written, patients have to be seen clinically, even if you can't just write a repeat prescription. So it was just our complaints. What are we doing about that?
So the first question in terms of warm transfers, I agree that the KPIs that we currently collect on more kind of customer service type KPIs are not really quality based KPIs. So the new national service spec, that warm transfer one, won't be continued, and the emphasis is less on where the patients have been warm transferred and more on how quickly that patient's actually got that advice. In terms of increasing access to clinicians within it, there's a lot of recruitment programmes ongoing, so offering flexible working to clinicians, because we find that there are some very peak times around about 6 to 8 p.m. So it's difficult to ask someone to come to work for 2 hours and then go. So if they can work from home, they can log on and take some calls with them. So there are initiatives like that ongoing. In terms of the repeat prescriptions, when patients are given the repeat prescription, it's generally for a couple of days, just to tide over the GP opens here, so it doesn't interfere with that usual cycle of GPs with the inpatient medications. It's just if you run out over the weekend.
That's probably an answer question. The repeat prescriptions for more than one, as Sarah said, are just to tide over for a couple of days so that patient isn't without a medication, and that tends to be over a weekend period. Often seen on a bank holiday. All encounters with NHS 111 are related back to the general practice. And so as GPs, clinicians are updated on encounters that patients have with antivirals and 111 over the weekend and out of the period. And so any prescription requests will be highlighted and practices can encourage patients to come in and have their medication reviews. But it is only for a couple of days. It's not a monthly prescription. That would interfere with their regular monthly prescriptions. And I do know that the 111, if they are having repeated requests from patients, that they are highlighting that language to practices in terms of ensuring that those patients are followed up. We often see this around opiate prescriptions, opiate medication prescriptions. Less likely around antihypertensives or some thyroid medications, but it's more tending towards opiate medication, and obviously we keep things with some of those medications.
I should apologise, I didn't introduce Dr. Paul Cowan, who is the Wirral CCG. I didn't realise you were going to be part of this presentation. Thank you very much for that contribution. I've got Councillor Gilchrist, followed by Sam.
Thank you, Chair. So the welcome bit of the report about faster clinical advice for children. That section of the report talks about the call holding out of the rhythm, trying to get my tongue around that. That in the past has been the chief worry that people dying might have, that you go through a whole series of questions which take some time, and people then worry about the experience of the call handler. So what can you do to assure us that this improved system improves those aspects and has people who are not just reading a script or working through a series of options but have got the knowledge of the conditions? And secondly, does the contact with local GPs do whilst Wirral prides itself on having care records accessible within the system, do people in 111 are they able to access records and when somebody rings up, punches up and says, yes, I can see you've got this problem in the past, or whatever it might be.
Okay, so in terms of clinical advice for children, so they bypass the usual algorithm by understanding questions and also about people who do go through the algorithm. So the NHS 111 health advisors are not clinicians, they go through a period of 6 week training programme, so they can recognise life threatening conditions. But they're not medically trained as such. There are
They don't currently have access to World Care Record and Health Information Exchange. So what we're working on is a system called Orion, where they are actually looking across the Northwest in terms of being able to access records, because they recognise that paramedics and also 111 do need that access to allergies, medications, etc. So it's something that we're looking at as part of a wider remit, rather than just where we are, our World Care Record and Health Information Exchange. It's looking across the wider patch, Liverpool, Manx, etc. So it is something that we are looking at.
Thank you, Jen. Thank you for your report. So the results that you shared and talked us through on page 5 of your report almost all go in a positive direction. Could you give us a little bit more information about what's been done to improve some of those reports?
So there's been a lot of work with those on recruitment and retention, focusing on individuals, so individual health advisors, time they take to answer calls. They've got a lot of individual kind of supervision, so there's that feedback. Hopefully, in the very near future, there'll be a new call centre opening in Liverpool at Scrutiny Point, so that should give even more capacity, because there has been limitations around the kind of pool of people that can recruit from. So the main call centres is in Bolton, and the kind of pool of people is kind of exhausted. So, in terms of flexible working, I mentioned before, we've been looking a lot at making our shift patterns a lot more, I suppose, attractive, and employing more full-time folks, whereas previously we had a lot of part-time folks, making those kind of a variety of roles for people. Does that answer the question?
It does, thank you. And so in terms of then the trajectory of the results, the changes that you've implemented, have these results got any better they will do based on the changes, or the next time we see them, are we expecting the same direction?
So I'm expecting them to continue improving. It has been, after historically quite a performance, we have seen some really good improvements, and I think with the new call centre, we all feel as well, I'll be expecting to improve.
Okay, thank
you.
Councillor Jones.
Thanks, Chair. Just following on from Kate's question about the budget there and the prescriptions, it was just a quick question. If you are prescribing, say, 2 days worth of medication for somebody and they then have to go back to their GP, I'm assuming then they have to pay twice their prescription charges, is that right?
My understanding is they don't pay for the one prescribed by just 111, but I will have to do clarify.
Can you do that, please? Thank you.
My question was something that I raised at the last time we discussed the 111 service. I spoke about the fact that I was unhappy with the so-called clinical acumen of the person on the end of the phone. You did refer to 4 people complained about the level of questioning. I was assured at that point that you were actually going to implement better training for people on the end of the phone, so that they would actually be able to interpret what someone was saying and pass them on to the relevant professional. Has that happened?
In terms of the complaints, my understanding is the level of questioning is probably, the company's algorithm is quite comprehensive, so it's probably around too much questioning. By comprehensive, I mean lengthy. So that's probably around too much questioning, and patients have fed back that sometimes they feel the question isn't particularly relevant to their condition. I don't know the specifics on the training, but I can find out.
I think probably just worth adding that it's really important for us that we feed back any local issues into that regional group, and so I was trying to sort of share the approach that's being taken currently. But if there are any specific experiences or issues, concerns, queries that people have, it would be very well to take those away and come back to that regional group of people.
Captain Hayes?
Thanks, Chair. Genuinely interesting report. I think it shows how innovative healthcare is being delivered nowadays. And what really struck me is the 111 online service. Can you just tell me how that's been developed, and has there been a big uptake in that?
Yeah, so 111 online service is a national initiative from NHS Digital, so it's been provided to CCC. obviously the chatting service will always be there because there are people who would prefer to use it, but 1-on-1 online frees up more capacity of people that do know that. In terms of numbers, I think there's some report. So we've seen